Welcome to our second edition of Inclusion Times. Here we are with Jnanesh, HR Director, Salesforce. Thank you, Jnanesh, for giving us this opportunity to pick your brains and insights on different inclusion topics.
My pleasure, Prateek. Thank you so much for inviting me for this.
Sure. Let me start off with the first question, which is around gender diversity. As part of a survey which was done by Grant Thornton, they figured out that India ranks among third low countries wherein we have women in senior leadership roles. Around 17% of leadership roles are just for women. Remaining, I guess, is not there. Similarly, there are around 41% businesses who do not have any women in senior leadership roles. Your thoughts, your insights, how we can actually think of actually bridging that chasm?
Yeah, so thanks, Prateek. My view would be that it has to happen at a short-term plan and a long-term plan. If you go back and see why this has happened, we have a cultural background in which we all have thrived, in which the corporate sector has come up. And to suddenly evaluate with a new set of metrics, which is in comparison with the advanced countries, it would be unfair on our part. So we need to do our homework right, in my view. You almost have a 50-50 ratio in your high school, and then you know, the same thing happens in the college. All the ranks are generally backed by the girls in schools. But then what happens when they get into the corporate segment? Where is the leakage happening? Why are we not seeing a good mix of people or a good mix of ladies in the mid-management category? So that the pipeline, if you want to use a sales analogy, is becoming weaker and weaker. So at the starting point itself, if you have 80-20 kind of a distribution, that is not going to help in the long run anyway. I think that is one of the reasons. Secondly, if you look at the top management, which you are referring to, the 17%, I'm sure all of them have earned their places to be in that glass ceiling or the corner cabins. Now to call them as women leaders, I think it is unfair to them. So my view is in a performance-driven culture, where output is going to determine your career progression, it would be unfair to create a different sense and an unfair competition between men and women.
Okay.
So my point is that you have a long-term approach to understand why it is leaking at the entry level, and a short-term, not a short-term approach, but there are no quick fixes in my mind.
Okay.
I'll give you two examples. One is when you start giving a mandate to the recruiter or the recruitment team that just go and hire only female population this year from the campus, it is a short-term. It'll have more negative bad blood amongst the boys and girls than giving the right message.
Agreed.
And at a senior level, when you start promoting people and saying that we want to promote ladies into these kind of positions, it again gives a wrong message in the. So there has to be a genuine intent and a well thought through plan to a desired impact.
Agreed.
That is what I would look at.
Agreed. So just to sum up, somewhere I would say is what you are rightly saying is identify why the leakage is happening, why even though in school and colleges we have an almost equivalent proportion of men and women or girls and boys, right? Somewhere probably in the, when they are joining or somewhere in the middle career level, we see a huge drop in the women proportion. How we can actually bridge that? And of course, the only criteria to go on the top senior roles has to be meritocracy driven.
Correct.
And because then it's all about leadership, it's not about gender there.
Yeah.
Right.
And I also want to bring in a slightly larger angle to this, and that is, look, you won't get everything in life as if I can quote Indira Nooyi,
yeah,
right? You make your choices.
Right.
And even the corporate world, you know, not everybody in the, if the number of taxpayers in this country is itself is, you know, in the range of 2 crores to, you know, 6 crores all put together, that means it's a very small population which is working in the corporate sector, and an even smaller population of women working in the corporate sector. Ultimately, it all depends on what kind of choices you make, you know, whether whether you want to raise a family, you want to be a corporate leader, or you want to do something which you are comfortable and enjoy doing it, which comes to you naturally.
Right.
What we say is, which meets your competencies.
Okay.
Those are the things which we need to look at. End of the day, it's the choices they make,
okay.
or anybody for that matter.
Sure, great, great.
Yeah.
Jnanesh, a lot of times this diversity and inclusion topics which come up, they reflect or mirror what is happening in the West. Even though culturally and economically there is a gap and difference, I was wondering if you think that there are issues very specific to Indian context or Asian context which needs to be bubbled up and should be probably taken up by companies which are based out of this region around inclusion.
I think Prateek, it's a great question, and I totally mean that. First and foremost, I think the definition of diversity needs to be understood and agreed by all of us who are speaking on that. So everybody would define it differently. That is the first challenge in my view. And secondly, as you rightly said, you know, what works in the West may not work in the rest of the world. So it has to be, even the definition needs to be customized and fine-tuned to each of these locations where we are operating. It takes the job of you know, practicing HR people in that region to fine-tune the global policies and see what is relevant, and go back with their story and their version of why this fine-tuning is required. For example, if you look at, maybe I may be wrong, but then whatever I've heard in the past, in countries like Poland and China, you have a 30-70 kind of a mix between man and woman in the population. So what does diversity drive mean in that country, in that context?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe in the BPO kind of a setup is where I've heard of.
Right.
So it is important in my view, one, to understand the definition, second, to fine-tune that definition as it is deemed appropriate in the region, while the intent and the impact towards which we want to drive can remain the same.
Okay.
Third, which is very important, is are we doing it like a social justice, or is it a business requirement?
Mm-hmm.
Now that, if there is indeed a business requirement, which all of us know, then that has to be propagated. Employees need to be aligned with their thought process. It has to be communicated top down, obviously, so that people understand and realize it. And if you come to think of it, if I take a small example of, you know, for the sake of understanding this subject, if you have a North Indian setting up a shop in South India, and if there is a predominantly different kind of a population to which he caters, obviously he will have one of the sales boys of the four who knows that language, who understand that culture, who comes from that background, right? Why is he doing that? It's a question of a business case for him, who can reach out and drive that for business results.
Mm-hmm.
No, I think it's the same when you are in a large global MNC, which is dealing with different kind of products. The fact of the matter is 50% of the population is of a different gender, right?
Yeah.
So it is by default required that we need people from different, not just from a gender perspective, but also from different parts of the world.
Yeah.
So that's why I said we need to get the definition right and then elaborate to include everybody as part of that, or who is not falling into the definition of that.
Mm-hmm.
And the third one is the impact. What you would see, even if you speak specifically on the gender diversity issue, there are certain sectors, like for example the banking sector, where women probably would go much faster and ahead of the rest of their counterparts. driving the much required business case you wanted for, right? So it's a question of understanding the definition. Second, it's a question of fine-tuning that needs to our kind of setup where we operate. The business need is understood, that has to be communicated, and then look for examples which proves in that direction, and then you have the answer on the D&I. India is different. Visiting India is not understanding India. I've been telling this many times. India is complex by its own complexities. So you need to keep fine-tuning, and nothing is going to be the same. Even the definition may undergo a change over a period of time. Yeah, and Prateek, coming specifically to that, the question you asked about India. Look, the definition of diversity can, which country can be different as diverse as India is? So we have, if you want, the challenge between the haves and the have-nots, which is more of an economic question. You have regional imbalance. For example, Northeast doesn't get enough of industries and job and employment opportunities. So which obviously puts pressure on the large metros of this country. And so the answer is to have the growth of smart cities across the country, and so that everybody gets their due share. And so in that sense, you are distributing, and it's a very positive setup end of the day, right? There is employment generation happening. The four metros will be eased out. Otherwise, you'll have enough money but no water in this four cities. So,
yeah.
And it's a real problem end of the day, right? Yeah. For the best interest, it has to be distributed.
Yeah.
It makes much more of a sense as far as India as a country is concerned, that we cannot just have uncontrolled urbanization to a very few select cities. We need to, and I think also like one of the countries, like say in Africa, some country, they skipped one generation and they moved to the digital revolution. I think we have to do something like that. We have to emerge, we need to quickly have 100 smart cities emerging over the next maybe a decade or maybe less than that, so that we are able to foresee the future. We are creating employment, we are ready when it happens.
Yeah, reduce imbalance, regional imbalance.
In this as a subset, maybe you'll reduce imbalance, you will create more employment opportunities. I think they are existing, but the distribution mechanism is wrong.
Agreed.
That needs to be looked at, and maybe in that sense, a specific question on diversity for India. In that sense.
Agreed. Next question would be around multi-generation. So we very well know that, especially in the case of IT and ITES sector, in last 2 to 3 decades, we have seen that there has been an overwhelming presence of Generation X and Millennials. So two generations more or less. In next 3 to 5 years, that is going to change when Gen Z come into picture. Do you foresee a different set of friction or challenges around three generations working together, not just in IT space, but generally speaking in the industry, and with very different ways of upbringing and all that? I mean, considering how we were brought and how the new generation which probably would be joining our industry.
Yeah, so my my answer would be that we are all product of our respective generations. It's like the days of BSNL and Nokia and the Android thing.
Right.
But everyone comes with their own set of competencies. The trick is to stay relevant in any of these companies. As long as you're relevant, as long as you're making your presence felt for the right reasons, you will be required, you will be invited, and you will be much more sought after. But if it is a question, enough has been spoken about the millennials and their ability to do multitasking, etc. But the question is, what do you leave behind as your own legacy? Leaving behind is one part of it, but then coexisting is what you had asked me. As long as each one stays relevant, organizations, the corporate world, HR guys will create framework for coexistence, because then it's a business imperative for them to ensure that this system or this framework stays. I think it would be a good thing of people bringing their one side. You have the competencies, what the new generation brings in, and the changing competencies over a period of time. And then there is a rich experience which becomes relevant, which will take you faster.
Okay.
You will not probably do the mistakes what you've done in the past.
Agreed. Agreed.
And you will probably have a new set of leaders emerging who can foresee and predict the future.
True.
Using all the tools and technologies available, and prepare their respective organizations for the emerging challenges. So if you ask me, it is a question of staying relevant, staying what you bring to the table, whether it is new competencies, new experience, thought process, or the vision for the future, or how well you can club and bring the tools and technologies. And everyone has to coexist. I don't see a friction. If it is a business imperative, the companies will ensure that they will coexist. And that's what I would look for.
Yeah. Depending on which index we track, whether it is social development index or human development index, India is ranked below 100 countries, right? Whether it is quality healthcare or quality education or lot many other things, right? We are nowhere close to where we expect ourselves to be, right? As a senior industry leader, what thoughts or insights or action items which you think that we as a citizen should take or as companies should take, which will help us to say that or redefine our current ranking and say that, okay, next decade or so, we will be in top 50 countries as far as human development index is concerned?
Yeah, I think it's a much wider question. First of all, I think we need to be clear on where we want to be and what can enable us to take us there, which means what are the strengths which can take us there. When you look at any of these metrics, what you have been referring to, the sheer volume of our population, and to ensure that things like healthcare for everyone, or infrastructure, or anything for that matter, it's going to be a humongous task. So it has to be a combination of everyone whose interest lies to contribute to make things happen. If you think that a Swachh Bharat Abhiyan can be done by the government, it is not going to happen. If you think that only less than 5 crore Indians will pay tax and the rest of them will not, it will not happen. So first of all, I think it's a question of accountability of every citizen. Before you aspire and desire, how much you are willing to contribute, how much are you even if not contribute, at least not destroy. That is the first thing, according to me. And second thing is about what runs in our favor. It could be political stability, for that matter, which is required over a period of time to drive certain programs, which are especially the long-term ones. And the population which is young and technically who are quick to adapt to technology and things like that. The earlier one we spoke about skipping a generation and getting directly into digitization.
Yeah.
So those kind of things which we need to identify what is in favor of us and play to our strength. And the third one is it cannot be limited to any one sector. The private and the public sector and the NGOs and the government and everyone will need to work hand in hand. And it's going to be a very long drawn battle. It's not going to be like my earlier answer on short term and long term. This is going to be a long term and a very, very long term kind of a thing. So I don't think it is not going to be a year on year change in our list from the top 100 to jumping all the way to top 50, unless somebody is doing very bad than us. but that's not the way of evaluating our performance.
Yeah.
But having said that, it is possible. But then everyone needs to have a sense of accountability of what they have to contribute. Having said that, then I think the government scheme, when they need to drive this, has to be done in a very, very professional manner. I'm not calling it as a corporate manner, but in a very professional manner with deadlines which are realistic, which are adhered to, and a metrics which will enable them to announce that this is what we have done. And the taxpayer sees his value for the money he has contributed, he has provided. So this sense of nothing is going to happen, that should go away.
Okay.
Because we are in that direction.
Yeah.
And it is easy to display something and say that we are not doing so great, but we are in the right direction. And I think it's a long way to go, but we are going to be there. You know, we will win, if not immediately, definitely.
Great, awesome. Sustainability practices like supply chain diversity, or hiring of people with disability, empowering them, or other disadvantaged sections of society. These are things which probably are catching up in India. With your vast experience in past, do you want to call out a few of the D&I practices, best practices, which larger industry can emulate and can work on?
So Prateek, as you rightly said, this is a recent, not many decades we have seen this. But many companies, which I know of and I've also worked, have come up with a lot of innovative practices. And one of them is to first respect people for who they are and not give them a special sense of making them feel discomfort for being differently abled.
Yeah.
I think to accept them holistically, I think that's the first thing. Second, in most of these organizations, there is a culture which is prevalent, which is very welcoming and inclusive in the true sense.
Okay.
And third, the leaders walk the talk, the communication is consistent. It is not a flavor of the season that somebody sends a mail and then let's do this, or then after that something else comes up. No. It is a very clearly thought through process with a clear vision of what they want to achieve. I think so. These are the few things I have observed. One is respect. Two is creating a scenario where you play to their strength and not to their weakness. For example, those with a hearing impairment, probably they will work well in the garment industry where they just focus on stitching, right?
Right.
So I think we will have to understand and find out what are their strengths, and enable them to succeed on those factors, rather than trying to make them feel that you're a special privileged person, and then it actually works as a disadvantage to them. So then a culture which employees live in a very cohesive atmosphere, where any of these people can be seen together and not seen in isolation. And I think that is one I've practically seen in most companies, which is a great thing. And obviously it goes without saying that you have to create infrastructure for them to operate to their maximum. That goes without saying, and most progressive companies have also done that. but it's also the changing of the mindset more that the companies bring in. What differentiates between some companies who have done that but not seen the impact, and some companies have seen the impact? It's the change of mindset. It is a question of sensitization, which happens from the top, which happens from some small subgroups within, which will enable them to get integrated much faster and live in a very cohesive atmosphere where the people who are differently abled don't feel a sense of threat, don't feel a sense of isolation, but they feel welcomed, they feel respected. And I have heard one of the head of an NGO who himself is blind, that he says, my objective is to see that all my people are taxpayers of this nation. Now, till such time, I think we never ever thought that we want them to be a taxpayer, right? The sense of pride, most of the guys who are normal in that sense, they find ways and means to avoid tax, right? But here is somebody who says that my objective is to make my people pay tax, and then they live with dignity, they live with pride, and they also contribute to the nation.
Yeah.
Now, I think that is when you can say that you have created the right impact. So in my view, I think what I've seen is from the companies is a very positive outlook, which leads to a very positive impact.
Thank you, Jnanesh, for the opportunity you have given. It was a pleasure having you on Inclusion Times.
Thank you so much, my pleasure.
I hope that in future we will again pick your brains, again we'll have this interaction and discussion. It was an awesome time, the whole discussion which we had in a very congenial environment. And Jnanesh, not just because he's sitting next to me, he's one of the most modest HR leaders I have ever met. Thank you, Jnanesh, again.
Thank you, my pleasure. Thank you so much.
Thank you.